Welcome to Cyberpsychology, the study of online behaviour. In this new environment, we can be whoever we want to be, but who are you? At the moment, there's two basic topics that I'm interested in. The first one is leadership in an online context. And what this really means is that when we look about, we have years of study of leadership, but now in this new online context, we're wondering, does it actually translate? If you're a leader in a face-to-face context, can you actually transfer that into the online? And what we find is that it's not really the same way. I mean, even look around this room, it's pretty clear in this room where the leadership is. It's the person at the back who is watching everyone. And everyone down here acts like that's the case. But in an online context, there's no observer, there's no individually spaced out roles. It's not like that. So what you do find is that leadership transfers and it works in a different way. You have some people who will lead in an online context easily, but they won't be able to do it in an offline context. So we have a minimization of authority, and we have different, I suppose, status symbols and means in which people convince and persuade. What I'm also interested in, though, is something, again, which is evoked by this room, is the phenomenon of cyberbullying. The problem with cyberbullying is that when you try to compare traditional bullying in the school context with what happens in the online context, it doesn't really work. For the most part, children who are cyberbullied may not know who's cyberbullied, who is attacking them, because it can be anonymous. Again, on the other side, the bully needn't necessarily have the same attributes online as they do offline. Because, you know, in a playground environment, it's usually the biggest kids who are the bullies. But in an online context, anybody can do it. In this online context, what is really important for people to realize is what you might call to have situation awareness. So one thing that people are struggling to conceptualize is that when you're online, that you're talking to way more people than you actually have any conceptualization of. Like, you're not really aware of it. So you post something up on Facebook and nobody likes it, nobody replies. You think that nobody's seen it. But in actual fact, what was more likely is that in the region of 10 to 100 people at least have seen it. And that's usually a good multiplier. If 5 people like it, you can probably estimate that at least 50, if not 500 people have seen it. And that is something which, it has another knock-on effect, is that it means that when you're online and you're not aware, you're not publicly self-aware, you're not aware of how many people are watching you, you tend to reveal more information about yourself. You tend to self-disclose. So people will tend to give away personal information, which they wouldn't do face-to-face. So how do we, as cyberpsychologists, how can we help you today watching this? Well, the first thing that I would suggest that everybody does is to try and learn how to protect their own identity online. And there's a couple of easy things that you can do to learn about this. The first thing is, in any of your online profiles, log out immediately and then go and look at your public profile and have a good long look at it. I mean, for the first thing you'll find is that you probably start to maybe be a little bit embarrassed about the things that you've said publicly. You might find that you're revealing a little bit too much personal information, and these are settings which you can change. It's also useful to bear in mind that these social networking sites, they're constantly changing because of the amount of information that we're all putting into them. We're actually building these networks, but they're also constantly changing from the point of view of the architecture. So Facebook changes its design roughly every 6 months, maybe 3 months, and it's to keep you interested so that you never get used to it. So it can often be useful to take a break from it yourself for maybe, you know, a week or two, and just to get find out what you're missing and what you're not. In these days, we are talking about ubiquitous computing, whether it will be computers and processing all around the world and in every aspect of our daily lives. What I'm most interested in is the sort of computing which we're now carrying around with us. What we still call them is, we call them smartphones, and it's still like an idea that this is something that we use to communicate with one person, that we pick it up, we answer it, and it's a communication channel between two people. But when you see the way that people are using these things now, it's quite different. And we're starting to talk of them in cyber psychology as a transitional object. A transitional object is actually used to refer to something like a teddy bear or a security blanket that children have to wean themselves off their mothers. And that this is how we treat our mobile phones. So what I would like everyone to, particularly when you're watching this, to take cognizance of these things, and when you're dealing with your mobile phone, not to think of it as a phone, but more of a portal, and a portal into a completely new environment where you have access to all of the information the world has ever had. And this is where an environment which we're still acting in similar ways to where we are offline, but in different ways as well. And it's a new environment which we don't yet fully understand. I hope you found this very interesting. And if you'd like to hear more about this, please subscribe to the channel below.